I'm Francine Pelletier. I'm the host of the Leader Series presented by Friends. All the political leaders have been invited to participate in this series. Today, for our second episode, the leader of the NDP, Mr. Jagmeet Singh. Hello, Mr. Singh, and thank you for agreeing to do this.
My pleasure. Thanks for having me.
Let's talk first about the good old CBC. It seems that it's sort of, you know, dropped off the radar. Not too many people talk about the CBC or are that willing to defend the CBC. As you know, that was the prime mission of Friends of Canadian Broadcasting. The bill we've just heard so much about and we'll be talking about would have been a wonderful opportunity to, you know, modernize the mandate of the CBC. There was nothing there. The CBC, as you know, is doubly threatened, lack of funds, digital revolution on the other side. What would you do to help the CBC?
Well, I really believe in public broadcasting. I think it's an incredible way to get people access to information. It is something that levels the playing field. And in a world where there's so much advertising that is driving the shows that we watch or the channels that are out there, to have something that's funded by the people for the people, I think is phenomenal. So I want to get to a point where we are properly funding our public broadcasting. If we look around the world, we are amongst the lowest funded when it comes to public broadcasting. So I want to properly fund it, make sure CBC doesn't have to rely on revenue from ads and is able to deliver quality content that actually speaks to what Canadians are going through and gives them information to make good decisions.
So it's a meager $34 per person per year right now, the budget of the CBC, which is, as you say, very low. Would you be willing to up that to $50 per person per year?
Yeah, I want us to get to a point where we are no longer amongst the lowest funded in the world. We need to be competitive with what other jurisdictions are doing around the world. We want to have a properly funded, well-funded public broadcasting. So I'm open to looking at what a properly funded budget would look like. And so I'm definitely prepared to increase it. And I want to be very open to a proper level of funding that would allow for content that reaches the length and breadth of the country.
And would allow perhaps for less commercialization, less ads on the CBC. That's an ongoing controversy. I think you are aware of what was announced in the fall by the Catherine Tate, the tandem, which is sponsored content on the CBC. What's your position on sponsored content?
Well, the tandem concept I'm really worried about because it's not the same thing as just an ad that plays and people know clearly this is a commercial. When it's sponsored like that, it kind of blurs the line. People might feel like this is public media, this is public distributed content, and it gives a false idea that this is something being perhaps endorsed by our public broadcaster. So I'm really worried about that. I understand the struggle and looking for creative solutions. I want to get to a point where CBC does not have to rely on that type of revenue entirely. They're free from having to rely on ad revenue because of the questions that it raises around integrity of the public broadcasting climate and that forum. I think it's so important to maintain that and keep it public and keep it focus on people as being the only driver.
What about going one step further and saying no ads on the news platforms, you know, on the basic mission of the CBC, information to Canadians? Would you be willing to say it should be ad-free?
I think that makes sense and I would support that. Yeah, I think it's particularly when it comes to our news that would be completely ad-free. It would really give a sense of independence and that this is public broadcasting, providing people with information. I think it makes a lot of sense.
Why is it getting harder and harder to defend the CBC, do you think?
I think it's one of those cyclical problems. Once you underfund a platform, it has less ability to get out and do the content necessary, and then less people are paying attention, and then there's less funding, and then it's kind of this cycle that makes things more and more difficult. Properly funded, public broadcasting can be of the highest quality, is very popular in other countries. We know that BBC, for example, is something not just viewed in the UK, but something that's seen around the world because of the quality of public broadcasting. So I think it's a matter of when you underfund something, it's kind of like what happens to healthcare. When healthcare is underfunded, then people start worrying about the access to service, and then there's more and more private options, and then the public gets less and less funding, and eroding the public funding makes the public option worse and worse. And that's why I'm very determined to fight for public programs in general, whether it's our public broadcasting or healthcare. When it's properly funded, it is there for people when they need it, and it continues to have the confidence of people. When it's underfunded, that confidence or that attention starts to erode.
Let's move on to Bill C-10, because there's a lot to discuss there. You know, there's been so much talk for so long from the present Liberal government about doing something about big tech, leveling the playing field, et cetera, et cetera. We've now just learned that Bill C-10 will probably not ever be adopted. Why? Can you tell me, first of all, why we've been talking about this for so long, and technically people, there's a majority consensus behind this, and we're still at the starting point?
Really big question, and a frustrating question. I would say at the heart of it, and I don't take any pleasure in pointing this out, but the Liberals have mismanaged this. They didn't present it with enough time. And the other issue is that they're threatening an election when we could go back to Ottawa and continue to work on this and get this to the point it needs to be. So really, it's mismanagement from the Liberal government. They could have timed this better, brought it in sooner, or also committed to coming back to Ottawa in September and making sure the job is done. So on both fronts, it's to be blamed. And really at the heart of it, what is this about? I put it this way to Canadians, and they agree. Why would we give an advantage to a foreign international broadcasting company when Canadian companies have to follow certain rules of contributing to the Canadian culture or contributing back to a fund or ensuring that there's Canadian creators that are on the platform? Why would we then allow Netflix or Disney Prime or Disney Plus or Prime to come in and operate in Canada, make money in Canada, but not follow the rules? Why would we give advantages to international companies and disadvantage to our local companies? That's really at the heart of it. And I would never support an uneven playing field where Canadian companies are at a disadvantage and foreign companies are given an advantage. That doesn't make any sense. So leveling the playing field just is something that is a fairness question. And it's about our sovereignty. Why would we not want to ensure that our Canadian broadcasters are able to compete against some of these international ones that don't have to follow the rules?
Again, I mean, I think everyone agrees with that, and yet we're back at square one. There was four bills promised, you know, on four different subjects: broadcasting, the online harms, paying for the content, etc. And we've got none so far. You said the Liberal government mismanaged it, but I'm sort of curious about the NDP position, because technically, you're all for this. It's in your platform. You want to see this done. And yet, during the last couple of months, we got the feeling it wasn't quite clear. You seem to have gone down the rabbit hole of the censorship question. The whole thing seemed to have imploded when there was the segment about user-generated content that came up. What is exactly the NDP's position on this?
I appreciate the opportunity to be really clear on this. We absolutely support leveling the playing field. We've never and will never believe that a foreign broadcaster should have advantages over Canadian broadcasters. And we've always maintained that it's important to protect freedom of expression. There's absolutely nothing in what was proposed that would any way jeopardize freedom of expression. And there were concerns, though, that the Liberals did not do a good job. They admitted it. You know, their minister admitted it, did not do a good job of communicating this. And the Conservatives exploited that poor management and bad communication and were able to create and inflame a fear that is unfounded. But because of that fear, a lot of Canadians were confused, and it's something that the Liberals now have to fix. We've got to fix that by making it really clear. And they, again, have an opportunity. We can go back to Ottawa in September and get this done. I want to get this done.
But you did give the impression at times that you did think there might be a problem of freedom of expression. Is there for you with this bill, is there a problem with freedom of expression?
Well, a couple of times what happened is there was a number of concerns raised. And what we believe as a party is if people are worried about something, it's important to provide information to dispel those fears. And so there were a number of analyses done using the charter and whether any of the charter rights were being infringed on. And those analyses came back saying, no, there's no infringement. I think that's important. Maybe one of the ways we can counter misinformation is with good information. So while people were raising that concern, we acknowledged that people had this fear. Let's see if it's founded in anything. And there were a number of ways where that was addressed. But again, it comes down to the poor communication at the onset from the Liberal government. They mismanaged this, poorly communicated it, created a conflict and a crisis, which the Conservatives then tried to exploit. And that's where we're at.
How much is this impasse, let's call it, the impasse about C-10, how much is it a question of lobbying? How much is the government and all the political parties susceptible to lobbies from the big tech companies?
Well, I can say with all confidence as leader of the party, we are not at all susceptible. We've called for taxing Netflix and taxing the web giants and taxing Amazon, which operates again in Canada, makes record profits here and pays no taxes. So we want all these web giants, all broadcasters to contribute fairly. And that means paying fairly, contributing to Canadian content fairly, and making sure they follow the rules, just like any other broadcaster would. So we are adamant about that. But we've seen, and it's sad to say, we've seen that there is a bit of a revolving door with some of the web giants who work for the web giants that end up being in the PMO's office, in the Prime Minister's office, and then rotating out. There's been some stories written about that. And it does look like on many occasions, the Liberal government has chosen to protect the profits of web giants at the cost to Canadians. When it came to Netflix, we said they should be paying their fair share. And instead, they struck this kind of secret deal and they didn't actually contribute what other broadcasters would, given how much money they're earning off Canadians. There's a number of times where it looks like they chose not to go down the path of making sure they pay their fair share in terms of taxes, where other countries like France have shown there is a way. They propose taxing the revenue for companies that aren't registered in Canada but make profit here. There are ways and we can tax the revenue. So there's a number of examples where the Liberals have shown very clearly that they're not prepared to take on the web giants and make sure they pay their fair share.
So what would, there'll be a new parliament. What would ideally an NDP government do to what's the right way? You say we have to, it's imperative to get this right. Mm-hmm. What do we have to do to not only to get this right, but to get this passed?
We need to explain clearly to Canadians, and Canadians have the sense of fairness. We've got Canadian broadcasters. They follow the rules. They contribute to Canadian content. They make sure Canadians are on their broadcast. We should make the same rules apply to foreign companies. Canadians would agree with that. We make it crystal clear with the amendments that we were proposing that would have addressed any concern with really explicit language. Make sure that explicit language is in the bill that says there is absolutely no infringement on freedom of speech. And we can move forward. That freedom of speech argument is a bit of a red herring put in there by the mistake of the Liberals for having mismanaged it, but then the Conservatives really exploited it. I think we can combat that with really clear communication and make it clear that this is about defending Canadian broadcasters and the spirit of having Canadian companies not having a disadvantage. We never want that to happen.
But can you be more specific? Because, for example, if you look at the bill as it stands now, C-10, the CRTC under the new law would still be able to waive the regulation for Netflix. It does not impose clear guidelines about regulation. It does not impose clear Canadian production. For example, Netflix says they've invested all these billions of dollars, but if you look, for example, in Quebec, one production. So how can we be like really hold their feet to the fire?
First off, we have to. I think that kind of that passion that you just demonstrate, that's the type of energy we need to put to this. We've got a responsibility. Left to their own devices, the foreign companies like Netflix and the other platforms don't have a vested interest in investing in Canada. They will not. If we want to create jobs in Canada, if we want to create a strong industry in Canada, and we know the world is more and more moving towards digital platforms, if we want to carve out a space for Canadian content in those digital platforms that also create jobs in Canada, that support our very thriving film and TV show industry, where we've got all sorts of talented people on set, and I've had the opportunity to work with some of these talented folks. If we want to keep that industry alive, those jobs here in Canada, we need to be very clear on Canadian content in filming in Canada, hiring Canadian teams, to be a part of those shows and what the definition of Canadian content is, how much of that has to be done with people from Canada for it to satisfy that criteria. I think Canadians want to see more jobs here, want to see our industries protected, and we can do that if we do it the right way.
And what do you do when Netflix turns around and says, there's no way we're going to abide by those rules?
I don't think they're going to turn their back on the profit here. There's an opportunity for revenue. There's an opportunity for profit. If we set up the rules clearly and they contribute fairly, this is something that that we have to not cave into just because we're worried about a company not following our rules. Why would we have the rules in the first place if we're going to cave in to a foreign company that says, I don't want to follow them? Well, that doesn't really show a lot of sovereignty. You know, as a nation, we believe that we want to support our Canadian content. It grew out of the fear of having a large neighbor with a very big presence. Having the United States would otherwise overwhelm our own Canadian content. It's important to have our own voice.
So what would be your priority in the upcoming government that will be formed, we presume, shortly? I mean, there's the broadcast law. There's the I know this is close to your heart about online stopping hate mm-hmm. speech and sexual exploitation, mm-hmm. about imposing payment for the journalistic content mm-hmm. that the big tech companies are pilfering every day. Mm-hmm. What would be your priorities?
Well, I look at the Australia model, and mm-hmm. I think that that's something that is an incredible opportunity that we see journalism across the country diminishing, and we see local newspapers shutting down. And it's I think, a big loss for a lot of communities. That was how they got their news and also were able to share local stories. But one of the really great opportunities we have, this moment of optimism that I have, is that the Australian model shows if we put in place clear rules around making sure web giants have to pay for content, they make incredible profits. Even a very modest fee for that content would actually reinvigorate the local media to the point that we wouldn't have a crisis anymore. So it gives me a lot of hope. Australia pushed forward, and their story is pretty phenomenal. They pushed forward. Initially, Facebook left Australia in opposition, but they stuck it out and Facebook's back, and now they're going to move forward with payment. They've shown that you can win. If you fight, you can win. And I've always believed that against big giant web giants, against large corporations, I've always believed if we come together and fight, we will win. And that's the spirit, that's the energy you have to bring to this type of fight. So I believe we can do it. I'm confident we can do it. And it would be in the best interest of Canadians. Paying for our journalistic content, making sure there's real clear laws around tackling online hate, sexual exploitation. These are things that should be happening. There's no question about it. We can't leave it to Mark Zuckerberg to deal with online hate. He doesn't have an interest in dealing with that. His interest is making profit, having more eyes watch and share any content on his platforms. That's not a good metric or not a good lens through which to be able to remove online hate. So I'm committed to getting rid of online hate and using all our powers at the federal level to tackle it. We know that it radicalizes people. It's one of the causes of violence against our fellow Canadians. So we need to tackle that. And we also need to make sure that there's a level playing field and we're not giving foreign companies an advantage over local Canadian companies.
Let's just talk about online hate for a minute, because again, no one would say the opposite of what you've just said. Everyone thinks that, you know, we have to stop the hate speech and the sexual explanation. Pornhub, for example, is a multinational company, one of the most watched companies on internet. Its headquarters are in Montreal. And they every day are using, you know, personal videos to make millions of dollars. So what exactly, how do we go about this? I mean, people talk about stopping this, but how exactly do we do it?
Well, let me start with online hate and then we'll move to the example of Pornhub. For online hate right now, and this is important for Canadians to look at, like, what are our options? Right now, we leave it to the social media platforms to deal with it. And they really don't. In some cases, we've seen some companies step up. Twitter has done a good job of regulating false information and labeling it as false. And so they've shown some kind of corporate citizenship. But should we leave it to the companies to deal with, or should we have a Canadian perspective that we can have say over what content is spread? And so we can use the tools that we have at the federal level to monitor and to identify any online hate and then to use tools through legislation to remove it quickly and immediately. And we've seen anti-Asian hate, we've seen anti-Semitism, we've seen hate against Indigenous people, Black people, we've seen Islamophobia have messages created and spread online, used to radicalize, and it results in harm. People have been attacked, people have been killed because of online hate. So it's so important, incredibly important for us to tackle it, and we have the tools to do so. We can do it. When it comes to exploitation, content that's up that is without consent, that is violence against women, has to be immediately identified and removed. And one of the tools that we can do is to give a mandate to the RCMP and other federal security agencies to investigate. There are some serious crimes being committed where someone is violently assaulted and it's captured on film and then it's uploaded. There needs to be investigations and there needs to be repercussions. And there needs to be some way to ensure that that type of content doesn't make it onto a platform. It has to be stopped and there should be consequences as well. These are some of the things that we should look at.
So when you say we have the tools, you mean we have the criminal laws able to stop this? Is that what you mean by tools?
Well, we've got significant powers at the federal level, and it's a matter of using those powers. So we might need legislation to be able to unlock those powers, but the federal government has the power to do a lot of things if given the legislative means to do so. We can ensure that our security forces are investigating material that's posted. We can have people hired to scan the internet to identify hateful material. We can set up opportunities for people to flag hateful material to a federal site, and then we can pursue it. There's ways that we can put in place mechanisms that allow us to tackle this. Really, what I think is a problem is the lack of political will. That so far, the conservatives before, the liberals now, have not made this a priority, haven't really decided to do anything about it. I think about the attack in Quebec, the massacre in Quebec City at the masjid. The attacker killed people while they were praying. This is in 2017. You know, how many 4 years have passed and the liberals have done nothing in those 4 years to actually tackle online hate? That to me is a problem. It's really the lack of political will.
But it's the political will, but I think the elephant in the room, to come back to what we were saying earlier, is that a lot of people think that the internet should not be regulated. That is the beauty, quote unquote, of the internet. It is free flowing, and that's what makes its beauty, if you like, its richness. And there's bad stuff, but you know, that's part of it. So isn't that part of the problem? Didn't we just see that happen exactly with Bill C-10? Yes, the conservatives weighed heavily on that, but there are people behind that. And that just don't want to see the internet regulated. So what do you do about that?
Now, there may be some people that believe in a completely unregulated, unfettered communication. I don't agree with that. I think that as Canadians, we have decided that we don't want messages that are going to incite violence against Jewish people. We don't think that's appropriate. I don't think that's appropriate either. I don't think that there should be an opportunity for people to use a large platform to disseminate misinformation about Asians, to encourage people to incite violence against them. I don't agree with that. Same for anti-Semitism or for violence against Indigenous or Black or any racialized people. And so we as a society have said there is a limit. We should not have completely unfettered in the sense that if someone wants to incite hatred, we've got hate laws against it. So similarly, online, we should have the same lens in place. If there is information that's clearly being disseminated and spread purposefully to incite hatred and violence against someone, no, that should not be allowed. And that is a limit that I think Canadians agree with. And that's a limit that just makes sense. And for those that don't agree, we already have made that determination in society that there should be a limit on what people say. If it's going to cause harm by inciting violence against someone just because of their identity, their religion, their color of their skin, we as a society have said, no, that shouldn't happen. That should not happen online either.
My last question, let me ask you this. How much of the problem that we're discussing, the difficulty of regulating the internet and the big tech companies, have to do with the political parties relying heavily, just like most individuals today, relying heavily on the internet and everything that it affords us to do? It has changed the nature of politics. It has changed the nature of the media. It has changed the nature of just about everything, how people relate. So it's a huge thing that we're looking at. How much of it is the political parties not wanting to tinker with something that actually, you know, is useful?
I think that is a great analogy for a lot of the problems we're faced with. Big polluters were exempted by Mr. Trudeau in his tax or his price on pollution. Big polluters were exempted. I imagine big polluters were exempted because they are powerful and influential. We see big banks often, or large and wealthy companies, use loopholes that avoid them paying their fair share. I would assume that the powerful were able to extricate these type of exemptions because they're powerful. But that is a whole role of government, to stand up to the powerful, to fight back against wealthy corporations that want to make more money or to exploit people or take advantage of people. That is why we have government. We come together as a society to say there are going to be forces, companies that have lots of wealth and influence that are wanting to exploit people and make more money.
But you're not answering my question about political parties, politicians needing this kind of interaction, free-flowing internet. How much is that part of the problem we're talking about?
Well, I'm getting to that point. Absolutely, fully part of it. Okay. You know, these are some of the wealthiest companies in the world, Amazon, Netflix, Google. These are some of the wealthiest companies in the world. And just like wealthy companies have all sorts of loopholes that that allow them not to pay their fair share in taxes, they've also created these loopholes that allow them to get away with what we would never allow otherwise. When would we ever allow a company to operate in our country, make money off the backs of Canadians, and not pay their fair share, not follow Canadian rules? We would never allow that. It's because of their power and influence. And absolutely, that has influenced the Liberals and the Conservatives, why they're not out there talking about making sure they pay their fair share, why they're not talking about making sure that they follow these regulations as well. We're the only ones saying that not only should they follow Canadian broadcasting laws, they should also contribute their fair share in terms of taxes. And we are prepared to use any means necessary in terms of using the France example of the 3% on revenue or other ways. Or the Australian model. We are prepared to do that. We're the only ones promoting that because we're not afraid. And we know that this is the role that we should play, standing up for people by protecting their interests and forcing the powerful, wealthy corporations not to exploit people, but instead follow the rules.
Thank you very much.
Thank you.